Summary. I deliberately started this book with a chapter on personal qualities because most people don't realize the role that people's skills play in real estate investing success. It is not just a matter of financing, buying the right property, getting tenants, and so on. All these elements are built on a foundation of having the right personal qualities. Great real estate investors like Trump are also great entrepreneurs. They know that they know how to get people excited about their bold ideas, and they are undaunted by the setbacks, problems, and disappointments that cause most people to give up. Be willing to pay a premium for a prime location. Don't buy without a creative vision for adding significant value. Four things Trump looks for in a location. Creative problem solving leads to big profits.
Cause we're living in a world of rules, breaking us down. When they all should let us be, we belong to you and me.
YOU, they heard the cliche about the three most important things. In real estate being, location, location, location. Trump thinks this is misleading. Location is important, but having a great location doesn't guarantee anything. It's a starting point for what could be a great investment. However, an inept real estate investor could own property at a great location and lose a fortune. One of the cornerstones of Trump's philosophy is, improve any location. In other words, use creativity and vision to change the way your location is utilized. Trump never gets involved with something that's just ordinary, it has to be very special. If he's building an apartment building, it has to be the most luxurious, and the biggest and best in the area. Small investors can adapt this principle by doing something radical to their property, changing the zoning, changing the way the property is used, or renovating it so strikingly that people think about the location in a new way. That's what he decided to do when he conceived the idea for Trump World Tower at the United Nations Plaza. Deal case study. Trump World Tower at the United Nations. When Donald first discovered this property in 1997, it contained a sprawling two-story building situated across the street from the United Nations in New York City. The building was the headquarters of an engineering society whose officers decided to sell the building because the value of land for new construction had skyrocketed, and given the prime location, they believed they could get a high price and move their offices into better space nearer the business hub of New York City. The zoning ordinance affecting the site limited the size of any new building on the property to a 10:1 ratio. Any new structure could be no bigger than 10 times the square footage of the land. Since the land area was approximately 37,000 square feet, this would have limited Trump to constructing a 370,000 square foot building on the site. Trump knew that the property was very expensive, but it was an entire block from 47th Street to 48th Street with an unparalleled view of the United Nations headquarters and the East River. He felt he had to build something extraordinary that would justify the high price of the land and take advantage of the sight lines of the property. Fortuitously, the existing zoning covering the property permitted the transfer of unused air rights from one parcel of land to a contiguous parcel on the same block. When the city wrote its zoning law, it wanted to limit the amount of bulk on a particular block but not necessarily building height. It didn't care if the bulk was in one building or 20 buildings. In other words, if a building on parcel A was 10,000 square feet but the zoning permitted a 30,000 square foot building, the owner of parcel A could sell the excess 20,000 square feet of building coverage, air rights, to the owner of parcel B. In fact, the building department liked the idea of the bulk being in one structure because it gave you more light and air everywhere else in the neighborhood. Since there was little likelihood that the owner of the unused air rights would ever use them, their sale to an adjoining owner who wanted them could fetch a price far in excess of their worth to the owner who had them. After making preliminary evaluations, Trump, thinking big, as he typically does, decided to build a huge luxury condominium tower using air rights from adjoining underbuilt properties. No other developer recognized this possibility, and it was the key to Trump turning this ordinary property into something extraordinary. But the process. 24. Trump World Tower at United Nations Plaza. 25. Would be extremely difficult. First, Trump would have to agree to buy the Engineering Society's property. Then he would have to convince the owners of the adjacent properties to sell him their unused air rights. In complete compliance with the law, Trump could then incorporate these air rights with the parcel he was buying and get a building permit for a much larger building. If he could buy enough air rights, he could build something really unique, the tallest residential building in New York City. The key to making this concept work was to acquire the air rights of adjacent buildings quietly. Building owners in New York City with excess air rights are often willing to sell them freely because they consider the dollars they get for the air rights as found money. But if word got out to nearby building owners about what Trump was doing, the prices for those air rights on parcels on the same block might have escalated through the roof. A difficult problem to be overcome was that only air rights on contiguous parcels were of value. He had to make a deal for the air rights on one parcel adjoining the one he was buying, and then work his way down the block to acquire the air rights on several parcels that adjoined one another. So he took options on various properties, offering the owners a high price, subject to his ability to acquire the air rights needed to form the chain permitted by the zoning. The outright purchase of all the adjacent parcels was impossible because one of the parcels was a church that might be willing to sell its air rights but never the church. Thus, we had several negotiations going on concurrently, and we had to conduct all the negotiations secretly. To help keep our negotiations for air rights simple, we offered the same price per square foot for the air rights to all adjoining property owners. If one owner got a higher price per square foot, we agreed that all other owners would get that same price. That way no owner could feel cheated. In some cases, we actually told an owner, "This is the price per square foot." 26. We agreed to pay John Smith for his air rights, and we are offering you the same deal. Having assembled air rights from seven adjoining parcels, we applied to the building department for a building permit to build a towering 677,000-square-foot building with 376 condominium units, the tallest residential building in New York City. We showed the city that we were in full compliance with the zoning resolutions and were entitled to the issuance of a building permit. We would be building as a matter of right, meaning we didn't need any special permission from the zoning board. The building department of the city of New York agreed. Some representatives said, "We might not like the proposed building, but it's perfectly legal to build it." They felt that if they denied issuing a building permit, their denial would be overturned in court and possibly lead to a huge damage award. So, the building department issued the permit. Trump immediately began construction. He did this to gain the advantage of having already broken ground, in the event a lawsuit was filed seeking an injunction against construction. As the scope of the building is the tallest residential building in New York City and maybe the entire world became evident, a number of prominent residents in the community decided to oppose it. They tried to use political pressure but were told Trump was acting well within the law. A group of wealthy residents in the area, including Walter Cronkite, filed a lawsuit to stop construction, arguing that the zoning in this neighborhood was intended to permit something completely different. You can't build a 90-floor monster right in front of the UN. We explained that it wasn't 90 floors, it was 72 floors, it was 90 stories high because of higher than normal ceiling heights. Ceiling heights did not affect permitted square footage. The opposition didn't like that fact either, but what we did was entirely within the law. It is easy to understand that when this lawsuit was filed to stop the building, the lenders who had agreed to finance the construction of the building got nervous. They felt that there was a real possibility that the building might never be built as Trump envisioned it. But Trump had a plan B. He established a relationship with Daewoo, one of the largest corporations in Korea, who was willing to be his partner and would guarantee repayment of the loan if the planned building did not materialize. So now the mortgage lender wasn't worried about the adverse publicity or the lawsuit because they had this billion-dollar company, Daewoo, which is the equivalent of General Motors in Korea, to guarantee repayment of the loan if necessary. Meanwhile, the building kept going up. The opposition tried to stop the construction. They claimed that if Trump's building was allowed to be built, they would lose their beautiful views of the East River. They filed a lawsuit against Donald Trump and the city of New York for wrongfully issuing the building permit, but Trump filed a countersuit that sought damages as a result of the opposition's lawsuit and a judgment that the building permit was properly issued. The court basically ruled that the city had every right to issue the permit and Mr. Trump had every right to build the building under the permit. They were not going to issue an injunction in this case because the damages would be horrendous and it was unlikely that Trump's position would be overturned on appeal. They allowed the construction to proceed. The opposition lost in the lower courts and eventually took their lawsuit to the Court of Appeals, the highest New York state court. The Court of Appeals didn't even review the case to consider overturning it. Their comment to the plaintiffs was, "If you don't like the zoning law, change it." But any subsequent change to the zoning law will not affect this building, which is being built in accordance with the law as it now exists. Trump World Tower is now one of the most luxurious residential towers in the world and enjoys a 5-star rating. Many of 28. The apartments have maids' rooms, wood-burning fireplaces, and 16-foot ceilings. A 4-bedroom condominium sells for as much as $13.5 million. The building was a huge success and the construction loan was paid off long before its due date from the sale proceeds from units. Ironically, once the Trump World Tower was completed, some of the people who fought the construction because it blocked their views bought units in Trump World Tower because of its superior construction and far superior views. Perhaps the best example of paying a premium price for a piece of real estate occurred in 1962 when I was counsel for Saul Goldman and Alex DiLorenzo Jr., the multimillionaires I worked for early in my career. Since they were considered to be the most aggressive purchasers of real estate, they would get dozens of listings sent to them every day. Part of my job was to screen the sale offers and get Saul's opinion as to which ones were of interest to him. One day, a disheveled old broker came into my office and handed me a crumpled piece of paper listing an apartment house in Brooklyn Heights that was for sale by the family who had built it and owned it for over 40 years. The asking price was $860,000, which, at that time, was a lot of money. I didn't know whether the price was high or low, but I did know that Brooklyn Heights was a desirable neighborhood, so I brought the listing into Goldman. I told him the broker was a nobody, and I doubted his. Continued. 29. Ability to bring in anything worthwhile, but I thought it was worth bringing it to Sol's attention. Goldman took a quick look at the listing and said, "George, find out how many people the broker has offered this apartment house to." I did as I was asked, and when I went back into Sol's office I said, "He knows you're the number one buyer of property in Brooklyn, so you are the first person who is aware of this offer." After listening to me, Sol said to me, "I know everything about this property, the type of apartments, the rentals, how well it was built and operated, and I have been secretly trying to buy it for years without success. If the listing gets out in the marketplace, a bidding war will take place for the property and I want to avoid that at all costs. Go out and tell the broker your oddball client will pay $1 million for the property." I said, "Saul, they're only asking $860,000 for the building, so you could probably buy it for $825,000, why offer $1 million? Saul insisted that I do as he directed. I pleaded, "How can I possibly get the broker to understand the excessive offer?" Saul said, "Hey, you're the lawyer, be creative." I went back to the broker who was still sitting in my office and said, "My client likes the property, but there is a serious problem. The price is too low." Thinking he heard wrong, the broker said, "You might be able to buy it for $820,000 if you move quickly." I replied, You're going in the wrong direction. Unless you up the price to $1 million, my client isn't interested. The broker had a look of total bewilderment on his face and asked, why would anyone pay $1 million for a piece of property that could be bought for $860,000? I replied, my client is a very eccentric millionaire. He thinks anything that costs less than $1 million is beneath him. So if you come back with a sales contract indicating a purchase price of $1 million, I'm authorized to sign it and give you a deposit of $100,000 immediately. But, I suggest you move quickly before my client comes to his senses. The broker came back with the contract the next day. I signed it and gave him the deposit. The amazing thing is that before title had even passed, Goldman obtained a first mortgage on the 30 property from a bank for $1.4 million. The property was that good. So Saul now owned a building he always coveted, and had pocketed $400,000. The seemingly exorbitant price in reality was an incredible bargain. By overpaying, he made sure the property stayed off the market. There's an excellent lesson here for the small investor. If your instinct tells you a piece of real estate has your name on it, and is significantly undervalued, go for it and forget the price tag. There will always be a demand for a prime location, and people will always pay a premium price to get a prime location. You have to avoid the trap of looking only at the average selling prices in your local real estate marketplace, and be willing to overpay, if overpayment is warranted. In other words, the so-called average market price of property is computed based on limited general information relating to an entire neighborhood, not the value of a specific property which may have a desirable size in a better location. You may have to pay 50% to 100% more to get a good property in a great location, but it's worth it if that will allow you to attract superior tenants or buyers, and if you can improve the site to get maximum value out of it. Trump World Tower was a perfect example of overpaying for a prime location. When Trump found it, the property contained an outdated two-story office building owned by an engineering fraternity. The amount of money they wanted for the site was outrageous. But Donald Trump paid it, because he knew other buildings on the block had unused air rights that could be purchased at reasonable prices and then he could build something extraordinary. Trump is always willing to pay a premium for a prime location, but he also knows that there's no right price for the wrong property. He will not buy something just because it's cheap, if he can't see a way to add significant value. The reality is that in smaller 31 Cation, if he can devise a plan that will dramatically change the way people perceive and value the property. To be attractive to Trump or to any intelligent investor, there has to be undiscovered potential for adding significant value to the property, value that is not already factored into the selling price of the building. For example, if the officers of the engineering society had known that it was possible to build a 90-story building on their property, they could have sold the concept to many other developers for a much higher price. Most people looking at the site would have seen only the potential for a 370,000-square-foot 20-story building, the limit permitted under the then-existing zoning restrictions of the city. W. Hat made the deal successful was Trump's creative vision for buying up the surrounding air rights, and using them to build a towering 667,000-square-foot structure with high ceilings, floor-to-ceiling windows, thus capitalizing on the site's potentially magnificent views. The genius of Trump was that he was able to put all the pieces together at a price that was consistent with the anticipated sales prices he would get for the condominium units. Though you may be a small investor, if you want to be extremely successful, make sure that you too have a vision for adding significant value to any property you buy. Think about your vision for adding undiscovered value before you get serious about putting any money down for the property. You have to think creatively about the ways to get the highest and best use out of a property. For example, you might buy a fixer-upper in a great neighborhood and renovate it, or build an addition, increase the number of units or the quality of the tenants. Other creative options are to build another building or amenities on the property, change the use from residential to commercial or vice versa, or seek a variance or a change in the zoning. These are all ways to enhance the value. The bottom line is, whenever you are considering buying an investment property, explore ways to improve the location.
de la mamá, de la mamá.